Rise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken. church family. All right, we're getting more and more people in here. I like it. I like it. Well, in honor of that, we're going to do a new song. Y'all fired up for that? Woo! Good morning, online family. We hope you're doing good. Hope you put your clapping hands on this morning. She's got it going on already. Hold on, lose heart. Hold my soul. Hold my soul. Hold on, give up. There is hope. There is always hope. No, there is peace in the storm. In the storm. No, don't forget. He is the Lord. He is Lord of all. Yeah. Come on. Nations bow, mountains shake, and at the sound of just one name over all, Jesus reigns. I know, I know, yeah. Nations bow, mountains shake, at the sound of just one name over all, Jesus reigns. I know. Hey, hey. Come on, put them hands together. Good to be gathered, lifting up the name of Jesus together. Oh, you make it easy to love you, yeah. And you are good and you are kind. You bring joy into my life. Oh, you make it easy to trust you, yes you do. You have never left my side. You've been faithful every time. Come on! Oh, all I want is you, Jesus. All I want is you. Oh God, come in this place this morning. We're here for you, yeah. Come and move, come and move. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, and I worship you, and you are here. Working in this place, our
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel 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 it, you Good morning, everybody. Ooh, loud. All right. I guess I started that early. All right. Glad that you are here with us this morning. I'm glad that we're having more and more confidence in meeting in person and that kind of stuff. We had a wonderful first service, and I plan on having a good second service as well. Thank you for tuning in. If you're tuning in online, we are so glad that you're able to worship with us as well. That's one of the many blessings that we've been able to find in this time that seems a little chaotic, yet we still see that God works through times where we don't feel we have a handle on it. We know that God does in that. Since we've been streaming our services, we've had people contact us from all over the United States saying that they tune in and that they watch regularly. So to be able to serve people that aren't in our community in that way as well is also such a blessing. But we still are looking for ways to serve our own community as well. And one of those ways is that we are feeding the Springville band this Wednesday. And we've got the food, we've got people to help prepare the food, but we need people to go help us serve that. We just need some more volunteers. It's going to be from 11 to 12 on this Wednesday. So we're going to meet here this morning, prepare the food. So if that's something you could help us out with, if you would just contact me, let me know, or contact Jerry and let him know, or Carrie, to let us know to expect you to be there to help us out. We would really appreciate that. The other announcement is one that you already know, just to keep in mind. Our students, we're going rafting July 25th. But that means it's going to be a fun trip. But in order for us to go and have that fun trip, we have to have some things knocked out first. That is on Facebook and on the parents group me and now on the students group me, there's links to sign the medical release form. I have to have that before you can get on the bus to go anywhere with me. And then the waiver for the ACOE rafting, whatever their name is. They've got an online waiver that we have to sign, have proof of that, and then the fee is $40. So that's coming up this Saturday. We need to have all those things knocked out if you haven't already, or if you haven't signed up yet, again, let me know. And if you have any other questions, please reach out. I can give you those answers that you're looking for. So as my week goes through, a lot of it goes towards planning out what I'm going to do for our students on Wednesdays, and then on Thursdays I get the blessing of Jerry coming in, and we get to discuss his sermon, you know, what direction he's going, and kind of give me some guidance on how I might want to open up the service, what passage, what verse, what our focus is going to be. He came in, he said, hey, I want you to find something, maybe focus on grace, right? What we're going through Nehemiah is going to see how important God's grace is in our lives. And the first thing that comes to my head when I think of grace, unfortunately, is not a Bible verse, but rather when I was in high school, anytime that I would get in trouble but still want to go out with friends, right, I thought that I could act like an idiot and then be like, you know, rewarded for it. My mom would say, if you can define what grace means, then I will let you go. And the example of that is, I'm going to give you something that you don't deserve because I was in trouble or grounded or whatever it may be. So when I think of grace, I immediately think of I'm in trouble in some sort. And so if I can remember this definition, you know, give her the definitions for grace and mercy, she'll let me go out with my friends and do whatever I wanted to do. And there's a little bit of truth to that, in that grace isn't always on my mind. But whenever I'm in trouble, grace is absolutely on my mind. Because if it wasn't for grace, I would be in a lot worse position every day than I'm in, than as a Christian our reality is. So as a Christian, you know, we think about what grace does for us when we're in trouble, and we also need to keep in mind what grace is and how God's still working in grace whenever times are going well. So I wanted to look at this passage. This is one of my favorite passages in Scripture. It's Ephesians 2, it's 1 through 8 is what we're going to read. So if you can get there, we're going to read Ephesians 2, 1 through 8. And he begins, Paul writes to the church in Ephesus, he says, you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. And then in verse 4, it says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And I love this passage. This is one of my favorite passages in Scripture because it reminds me where I've come from, what God's grace has done in my life, and now the blessings that I have because of it. And I get to, if we were to go through verse 9, I believe, of walking in the good works that he's laid out for me to walk in, right? That grace where I could not save myself, God saved me, and now I'm blessed not only just to be, not to just have salvation, but to then obey. I have the freedom to obey him, to please him, to pursue him, right? And I don't want us to lose sight of that. Grace is not just for when we are in trouble, though that is when we recognize it first, but grace carries itself out. God is giving us his grace by allowing us to be obedient to him and to live for him. So grace is all in the Christian life. From the beginning to the end, we live in God's grace. And I just think if I could grasp that a little more every day, what my life would look like, how I might serve y'all better, how I might love Clara better, if I could just grasp the weight of God's grace in my life. So let's keep that in mind as we continue to worship. I'm going to ask that you would pray with me now. Father, we thank you. Father, we recognize the blessing that it is to be able to be here in such a time as this, in such a time that seems so chaotic. Father, we thank you for blessing us with it. Father, we thank you for this ministry. Father, we thank you for this church. Father, we thank you for your grace. Father, I pray that as Jerry preaches and teaches your word this morning, Father, that we wouldn't just focus on him, but focus on you. Father, that you might remove the distractions and remove our pride, humble us before you this morning so that we would be looking to see you, to know you better, and to love you more. Father, I pray that your grace would just weigh on us and that it would inspire us to live differently, to worship, Father, and to be heartbroken over the lost, but built back up in your grace. Father, I pray that would be our reality, that we wouldn't forget who we were and what you've done, so that we can go and share that same love and grace with others. So, Father, I want to pray for our church this morning, that you would encourage us in that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you very much, Ryan. Well, it's good to see all of you today. Good morning. Whether you're with us in person or whether you're online, we are glad that you are with us. If you've been with us for any length of time in the recently, we have been going through the book of Nehemiah, and this morning we're going to be closing out our series on the book of Nehemiah. We began with Nehemiah back in March, and here we are, 19 sermons, 19 weeks later, and we're going to finish it up with the 19th sermon from the book of Nehemiah. So I want to invite you to turn with me to Nehemiah and chapter 13, if you would please. And I'm going to have a word of prayer. We've got several in our church family that we need to be remembering in prayer, and we need to pray about this morning. And so I would invite you to join me with that. Lord, we are gathered here together in your house and online, just wanting you to work in our hearts, wanting you to work in our lives, with our families, with our situations, no matter what it is, whether it be our household, whether it be in the hearts of our children, of our spouse, whether it be in the job situation that we're in, or whether it be in our health. Lord, I pray that you would just provide where only you can provide. I pray, Lord, for those that are in need of a miracle and a touch from you, that they would find that, that you would give that to them, that you would touch their body, that you would touch their situation. Lord, I pray that you bless Mark Phillips this morning. I pray that you would heal him, raise him up, do a miracle in his life. I pray for those in our church family with cancer, that you would just touch Don Adamson this morning, that your hand would be upon him and that you would bring healing to his body. Do an absolute miracle for him and in his life. It would be for your honor and for your glory. Lord, I pray that you'd be with Tammy Parsons. I pray that you would touch her body. I pray, Lord, that you bring encouragement to her children and to her family and to her parents, her brothers and sisters, that you would do a miracle for her and heal her. Lord, I pray that you would be with the Keith situation. I pray that you'd be with Sandy Jenkins and her health. I pray that you would be with Danny McCarley and Marcia Johnson. And Father, I pray that you would just continue to work in Christy's life. Christy Hicks, I pray that you would just continue to bring healing to her. And Lord, for us as a church family, I pray that this would not be a season where we are paused in ministry, where we're paused in reaching out, where we're on hold. I pray that it would be a time where we as individuals are doing more for your kingdom and for your honor and glory and for the sake of the gospel than we ever have before. Lord, use us mightily. And I ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ and for his sake. Amen. Well, the end of chapter 12 of Nehemiah's 13 chapters. At the end of Nehemiah chapter 12, we really should see it end with, and the children of Judah and Nehemiah, they lived happily ever after, because they got everything accomplished that they sought out to accomplish. What began in chapter 1 with a burden in Nehemiah's heart and a concern of him, where he wept and he prayed for months and months. But then he finally acted and he went before King Artaxerxes and he got permission to return to Jerusalem and to rebuild the walls around Jerusalem. They got all that accomplished. And they established people living back in Jerusalem. The people from captivity were being let go. People from exile were returning to Jerusalem. And they began to assign tasks so that the temple worship could continue. People were put back in place, the Levites and the singers and the temple workers, and the obedience of the people, where they were listening to God's word again. And they were, God's people were gathering back together and they were becoming God's people. And they were living out their lives in light of that fact that that was their identity of God's chosen people. So that's the way it ends with chapter 12. I mean, there's great joy and there's happiness and everything is the way it should be and the way God meant it. And you'd think it would say, and they lived happily ever after. Well, we know from chapter 13 that that is not the case. That isn't what happens. We know from chapter 13 that Nehemiah has excused himself from Jerusalem because he had promised King Artaxerxes back in Susa that he would just be gone for a short time and then he would return. And so now that time is up. So Nehemiah thinks that everything is accomplished, everything is where it's supposed to be. So he returns back to Jerusalem. And while he is gone, things begin to digress in Jerusalem and they begin to change. And so Nehemiah returns to Jerusalem, and the place that he left, the place that he built, the place that he led them to be is not what it was. It is not the way he left it. And so he finds that the people have restored and they have renewed their sin before God. And they begin to live contrary to what God's will was for them. And they willingly compromised here in chapter 13, we're going to see. They willingly compromised, they willingly neglected three very practical and important ways for them to be right with God. We see the first one in chapter 1, in verse number 14, or chapter 13, verse 1 through 14. Read if you will with me in chapter 13. On that day, they read from the book of Moses in the hearing of the people, and in it was found written that no Ammonite or Moabite should ever enter the assembly of God. For they did not meet the people of Israel with bread and water, but hired Balaam against them to curse them. Yet our God turned the curse into a blessing. As soon as the people heard the law, they separated from Israel all those of foreign descent. Now before this, Eliashib the priest, who was appointed over the chambers of the house of our God, and who was related to Tobiah, prepared for Tobiah a large chamber where they had previously put the grain and the offering, the frankincense, the vessels, and the tithes of grain, wine, and oil, which were given by commandment to the Levites. The singers, the gatekeepers, and the contributions for the priest. While this was taking place, I was not in Jerusalem. For in the 32nd year of Artaxerxes, king of Babylon, I went to the king. And after some time, I asked leave of the king and came to Jerusalem. And I then discovered the evil that Eliashib had done for Tobiah, preparing for him a chamber in the courts of the house of God. And I was very angry, and I threw all of the household furniture of Tobiah out of the chamber. Then I gave orders, and they cleansed the chambers, and I brought back there the vessels of the house of God with the grain offering and the frankincense. I also found out that the portions of the Levites had not been given to them. so that the Levites and the singers who did the work had each fled to their own field. So I confronted the officials and said, "Why is the house of God forsaken?" And I gathered them together and set them in their stations. Then all Judah brought the tithe of the grain, wine, and oil into the storehouses. And I appointed a treasurer over the storehouses, Shelemiah the priest, Zadok the scribe, and Pedadiah the Levites. And as their assistants, Hanan the son of Zachar, son of Mattaniah, for they were considered reliable, and their duty was to distribute to their brothers. Remember me, O my God, concerning this, and do not wipe out my good deeds that I have done for the house of my God and for his service. So the first area of neglect, the first area of compromise that Nehemiah discovers when he returns is they have neglected the temple. They have compromised the temple. They've made it into something that it was not supposed to be. Now, it wasn't that they weren't still going there. It was just that they had changed the whole purpose of it. And they compromised. They allowed certain things in. We find in Deuteronomy chapter 3, which is what they're talking about at the first part of chapter 13, is that they're telling a story that happened a long time ago when the children of Israel were going through the land of the Ammonites, that the Ammonites did not want them there, would not allow them to pass, and so they attacked them, and through God's strength and God's provision, the Israelites defeated the Ammonites, and they just wanted permission to go through the land to get to where they were going. And he says, since they didn't greet you with bread or with water or any kind of a help, and instead were hostile to you, they are always going to be hostile to you. And God said, you're not to allow them ever in the temple. They're not to be present when the reading of the word in the temple is done. They are not allowed in the temple under no circumstances. And you're not to be kind to them. You're not to show them peace. You're not to help them. We're going to just totally do away with them and act as if they don't exist. Well, here Nehemiah returns, and what have they done? They've allowed this Ammonite not only to be there under the reading of the word, but he's now living in the temple. So they've given him a place to live that was where it was supposed to hold the grain offerings and the frankincense and the tithes and all of these first fruits. Instead, they moved them all out, and they allowed this guy to move in with his furniture there in the temple. And so here is this Ammonite living in the temple. And so they totally compromised what the temple and what its purpose was and what the rules and the guidelines that God had placed for them. And not only this, but the priests are starving. They have gone back to work in their own fields so that they've got food, so there's no one attending in the temple. There's no one working there. The singers are gone. All of the workers in the temple are gone. Remember when they built, just a few chapters ago before, they built this platform for Ezra the scribe, the priest, to get up on to read from them the book of the law of Moses? Remember that when all the people beat their breasts and they repented and they confessed and they were so thankful to hear the word and they wanted it to go on all day, read more, read more, read more. And now it is no longer there. The priests aren't even allowed to work in the temple because there's no food for them and they're starving. Well, Nehemiah, he comes in and he throws Tobiah out. He throws his furniture out and he rebukes the officials. And he brings the grain offerings back in and he brings a place for the offerings. Then he puts trusted leaders in place that are reliable and are not going to compromise in this area. And then in verse 14, he ends this section about the temple with Nehemiah praying. He's praying. And then we continue this story in verse number 15. He says this, "In those days I saw in Judah people treading wine presses on the Sabbath and bringing in heaps of grain and loading them on donkey, and also wine and grapes and figs and all kinds of loads, which they brought in Jerusalem on the Sabbath day. And I warned them on the day when they were sold food. Tyrians also, who lived in the city, brought in fish and all kinds of goods and sold them on the Sabbath to the people of Judah in Jerusalem itself. Then I confronted the nobles of Judah and said to them, 'What is this evil thing that you are doing, profaning the Sabbath day? Did not your fathers act in this way? And did not our God bring all this disaster on us and on the city? Now you are bringing more wrath on Israel by profaning the Sabbath.' As soon as it began to grow dark at the gates of Jerusalem before the Sabbath, I commanded that the doors should be shut and gave orders that they should not be opened until after the Sabbath. And I stationed some of my servants at the gates that no load might be brought in on the Sabbath day. Then the merchants and sellers of all kinds of wares lodged outside Jerusalem once or twice. But I warned them, and I said to them, why do you lodge outside the wall? If you do so again, I will lay hands on you. From that time on, they did not come on the Sabbath. Then I commanded the Levites that they should purify themselves and come and guard the gates to keep the Sabbath day holy. Remember this also in my favor, O my God, and spare me according to the greatness of your steadfast love. So we see, first of all, they're compromising the temple, and now the second area of compromise is with the Lord's Day, with the Sabbath. And this is something that Israel knew full well, to remember the Sabbath day and to keep it holy. And yet they're not doing. They're disobeying blatantly this command. And they're not honoring the Sabbath. You know, this day is a day to set apart for worship. This is the day that they come in together and they gather together and they worship and they sing and they repent and they pray and they confess and they listen to the reading of the word and they get their priorities set straight. And yet they are not doing this. You know, God not only comes first, but God also gets a certain amount of our time from our week. And this was what it was supposed to be. And the command is always this: remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. So it's like, what day is it? Oh, it's the Sabbath day tomorrow. Hey, what is tomorrow? What is today? They knew that it was going to be the Sabbath, and you remembered it and you kept it holy. But it became just like any other day, a day to make money, a day to buy and sell. And their routines became no different than the people around them. They weren't going to the temple to worship God. They were going to the temple to get a good deal. They were going to the temple to make a trade and to meet their physical needs. And they were neglecting their spiritual needs. And so Nehemiah rebukes the officials, the nobles, and he even questions them and says, don't you remember how much trouble this brought to us before? Or do you invoke the wrath of God once again on us? And then in verse number 22, Nehemiah prays once again, remember me, O God, in your steadfast love. And then the third area where they compromise, we see in verse number 23, and it says this: in those days also I saw the Jews who had married women of Ashdod, Ammon, and Moab, and half of their children spoke the language of Ashdod, and they could not speak the language of Judah, but only the language of each people. And I confronted them and cursed them and beat some of them and pulled out their hair. And I made them take an oath in the name of God, saying, you shall not give your daughters to their sons or take their daughters for your sons or for yourselves. Did not Solomon, king of Israel, sin on account of such women? Among the many nations, there was no king like him, and he was beloved by his God, and God made him king over all Israel. Nevertheless, foreign women made even him to sin. Shall we then listen to you and do all this great evil and act treacherously against our God by marrying foreign women? And one of the sons of Jehoiada, the son of Eliashib, the high priest, was the son-in-law of Sanballat the Horonite. Therefore, I chased him from me. Remember me, O my God, because they have desecrated the priesthood and the covenant of the priesthood and the Levites. So this seems like something that we see all the time, where people compromise, and yet they had already confessed this sin and they'd already put out all the foreigners from them so that they could live as God's people and it wouldn't be diluted. They wouldn't be tempted to compromise. They wouldn't follow after these false gods and the gods of these people. And yet here they are doing this once again. They're willingly bringing these people back in. And I imagine the excuses were all the same. Oh, but I love him. Oh, but I love her. Oh, they make me laugh. Oh, they just fulfill me. I mean, I just feel so complete with them. I mean, I just need them so much. Don't you see that? Don't you see that? This area of compromise, they're intermarrying. Even the high priest's son marries a foreign woman. And remember this, we talked about this earlier, but God is not against interracial marriage. He is against interfaith marriage. And shame on the church, God's people, for one day, at one point in time, be condemning interracial marriage and never saying anything about interfaith marriage. That is what God is concerned with, because he knows that the compromise is more often going to go towards the way away from God than to God. I've seen people marry an unbeliever and see them come to know Christ through God's grace. They've come to follow, become a follower of Jesus Christ. But more often than not, they're drawn away from God's people. They're drawn away from following God, and they compromise. More often than not, that is the problem. And what is the deal? Why do they learn the language of the Ashdod of the foreigners and not the language of the Hebrew people? How come they don't do that? You know, the result is these children do not even know their own language. And how can they know their God if they don't know the language with which their God is taught? So Judah, the people of Israel, have moved farther and farther away from their identity as God's people. The temple, neglect, compromise. The Sabbath, neglect, compromise. The next generation marrying unbelievers, neglect, compromise. Remember when they had confessed their sins back a few chapters ago? Remember when they had confessed and they'd made everything right? Remember back in chapters 8 and 9 when they read God's word and they had this hunger for it and it lasted hours upon hours every day, and they had rebuilt the temple and they'd observed the Feast of the Tabernacles, begin to observe their Feast of the Booths, and the Sabbath day was holy once again, and they had separated themselves from foreigners. And yet now they have returned once again to these very same sins. I had an old pastor tell me one time, Dr. Simmons, I don't know if this is true or not, but he said this statement that it makes me think about it a lot, where he says, the sins of your youth will revisit you in your old age. And I find that very interesting because, you know, I'm still very, very young, and I don't know what that's going to be like in my old age, those sins of my youth. But he was warning these young guys, saying, the sins of your youth will revisit you in your old age. But I do know this, that repentance has to be lived out in the choices that we make daily. Repentance has to be lived out in the choices that we make daily. Nehemiah leaves, and in a very short amount of time, all that they had achieved, all that they had accomplished together, all that God had brought them to, they neglected it and they compromised. The implication is this: God's people are no longer living as God's people. They can't understand the language, so the young people are not reading the law. So if anybody did get together to read the law, there's no young people there. It's all old people, because they can't understand the Hebrew, so why go? And they walk on by because they're getting a good deal at the market right outside. And the noise from buying and selling and making a living is greater than the noise of the worship in God's people, because there's more people outside of God's temple than there are inside. If they can't understand the language, then they cannot read the law. If there's no law of God, then there is no authority in their life, and the next generation is lost. And that is so true. We are just one generation away from our family not knowing Jesus Christ and not claiming the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior. Well, in verse number 25, Nehemiah curses them, which is this. He tells them the implications of what they've done. This is the result, and this is what is going to happen. And this is what kind of a calamity you have brought upon yourselves and upon the city of Jerusalem. And he even goes so far as to beat some of them and pull out their hair. Now, Nehemiah is obviously a very scary guy, a very scary man. What we see in him in the first chapter, where he's a servant of the king of Babylon to King Artaxerxes, where he's weeping and crying for 4 months, burdened over the news that he hears of what's going on in Jerusalem, and that there's no wall to protect the people and there's no worship going on. And you think that he is maybe not as manly as he is, but he absolutely is a man's man. And he goes in like a wild man and begins chasing people out away from the temple. If he could get his hands on them, he would kill them. And it's amazing they've allowed this Tobiah and this Sanballat back in among the people, because these are the people that jeered the people of the Jews when they were trying to rebuild the temple. And Sanballat said, these feeble Jews can't do this. And now we see Sanballat running from his life because Nehemiah is chasing him, going to beat him up. is going to pummel him. And he's physically beating them and he's pulling out their hair. This is Nehemiah. And why is all this? Why is this all stressed? Because sin in the people of God is serious business. Sin among God's people is serious. You know, we can't excuse it. We can't just justify it. We can't just say, well, we're praying for them. Well, we've got to let them live their life. No, sin in people that claim to be God's people is very serious. Well, can you see the circle the people of Judah have made? It's very, very clear, very, very evident. They went from not regarding God as God to repenting and confessing. They went from being scattered and being captive, coming back to their homeland. And they come back and they're celebrated and they rejoiced. And they understood repentance and peace and security and happiness. And then for whatever reason, they slowly but surely began to throw that all away. I don't know about you, but that warns me that maybe I am susceptible to those same things. To throw those things away and to compromise and to allow this and allow that. And it'll be okay just this one time, which turns into two or three or four. But then they come back to the same old sin, back to where they started. I think Nehemiah reminds us of this, that there are three practical ways to stain in God's will. Three practical ways to stay where God wants us, to keep our heart right with God. It's very simple. The first is, don't neglect God's house and His Word. Do not neglect God's house and His Word. Do you know one of the statistics in America is that people are attending church less and less? It's not a problem with the church. It's a problem with the hearts of the people. You want to stay right with God? Stay in God's house. Go to church. Go to church. Don't neglect His house and don't neglect His Word. Secondly, don't neglect God's day. Think about your schedule. Think about your time. That God is over your time and He deserves a day where you honor Him, where you remember it and you keep it holy. And then thirdly, a very practical way is don't marry a non-believer. Don't marry someone who doesn't believe. I don't care how pretty they are. I don't care how handsome they are. Do not marry an unbeliever. We've seen a lot of great lessons from Nehemiah. We've seen that God's people are people of action. I'm thankful that Argo Christian Fellowship, we're a people of action. God's people are people that do. People that do. They build, they accomplish, and they do. They're people of action. We've also seen that there are people who are able to celebrate because they've repented, and so it brings this happiness, which we talked about last week, and this joy that we talked about last week. So they're able to celebrate, and we are God's people that celebrate. I remember back in January, remember when we had John speak to us from Hydrate Ministries? We were getting ready. Remember, that was this year. That seems like many years ago, but that was just in January. And John came and spoke. And in the middle of the service, he turns to me during the first service and says, man, you guys have something special here. And I said, you haven't seen half of it. You have not seen half of it. We are people that celebrate, that are happy, and that are joyful. And that's something that the world doesn't know. But God's people are people that are able to celebrate. And God's people are people who give. God's people, that's what we've seen with Israel, with this story of Nehemiah, that the people began to give and they began to take care of the needs. They began to do what needs to be done. They're people who give. You know, we had a meeting last Monday night, the deacons and the elders of the church. And, you know, I talked to a lot of pastors in communication with a lot of people around the country. And a lot of churches, some of them are not doing well at all. They're struggling greatly financially. And they've had to let staff go. They've had to make changes. They've had to cut back. Some of them are even in danger of losing their buildings, being repossessed, because they can't meet their payments on their building. And our report was, by God's grace, that we have $600 less in the bank today than we did the 1st of January when we started the year. You know, it shows that God's people give, God's people care. God's people give to God's work. We haven't had to let any missionaries go. We've not had to lay off any staff. God's people are people who give. all of these great things that Nehemiah has shown us. But then here we see, once again, in chapter 13, we're reminded of this very sad fact, that God's people are also people who sin. God's people are also people who make wrong choices, who compromise, who neglect. And if we're not careful, even committed people can compromise. Even committed people compromise. God's people are always people in need of repentance. Living for God shows the world just how incredible our God is. Our faithfulness to Him shows Him how faithful He is to us. God's reputation depends on the obedience of His people to a large extent, to a lost and dying world. We reveal to an unbelieving world just how much God loves us and God is able to forgive us. Well, Nehemiah rebukes the sin of the children of Judah. He calls it what it is. He doesn't make excuses. He doesn't justify it. He doesn't pray for them. He calls it out. He chases it out. He throws it out. And he confesses it and he purifies the people. Because repentance is not just asking for forgiveness, but it is a changing direction. This is not, does not measure up to repentance, so it has to go. This person should not be here, so they've got to go. Repentance is change, and it's change in direction and behavior. You know, Nehemiah's prayers in this chapter are very significant. They're very significant. Go back through and read them in verse 14 and 22 and 30 and 31. Read his prayers. They're very significant because he's taking responsibility for the sins of the people of Judah. He's seeing the big picture. Through himself, he's asking God to have mercy on these people. And he leads them again to renewing their faith. He falls on his face before God and asks God to remember him and not remember what he's done for the people and that he's done all that he could. Everything that's within his wisdom and within his knowledge and strength and within power, he's tried to accomplish it to bring the people back to God. It's like his motivation is this: I can only do what I can do, but despite everyone else going in the wrong direction, I will worship you, I will be loyal to you, I will serve you. And then he ends with, have compassion on me, God. I'm concerned about myself. I can't do it for everybody else, but have compassion on me. Well, the story of Nehemiah has been an incredible story, and I've said numerous times that if I was at a place where I could retire tomorrow, this would be the series I would want to go out on. I would love to retire after this series. The last words of the book of Nehemiah, the last words that we hear from this great leader, Nehemiah, he's not a priest, he's not a king. He's just a simple man, a servant in a foreign court, in a foreign god, serving a foreign king. But he's God's child, and God uses him to completely change history. And we see his last words in verses 30 and 31. It says this: thus I cleansed them from everything foreign, and I established the duties of the priests and Levites, each in his work. And I provided for the wood offering at appointed times, and for the first fruits. Remember me, O my God, for good. Remember me for good. Well, it's amazing. He's recorded as good in the scripture. We're remembering him all of these years later, Nehemiah, for good. He didn't stand out maybe for a world, but he stood out in God's sight. And God appointed him to have a book that recorded what he did and how he lived out his life and how faithful he was and how he overcame incredible obstacles and he never gave up. And his prayer there, remember me for good. Remember me that I invested my life despite what everybody else was doing. Well, that's how the story of Nehemiah ends. The book began with Nehemiah praying and it ends with Nehemiah praying. And this is also, coincidentally enough, where the Old Testament ends. Now, if you have your Bible, you look and see there's a lot of pages between here and Matthew, but this is where, chronologically, the story of the Old Testament we have recorded ends. There's some minor prophets in there. There's Zechariah and there's Malachi and Haggai that are in there right towards the end of Nehemiah's life. But after Nehemiah's, the story of Nehemiah, Ezra and Nehemiah, there is 400 years of absolute silence, 400 years that are not recorded, or there is no mention of what God is doing in the lives of his people on earth. There is nothing. This is where the Old Testament ends. And yet this next action or this next event that takes place, we find in Matthew chapter 1 and verse number 18, where God once again intervenes into the lives of mankind on earth. But this time it's not just for a temporary thing. It's not just to rebuild a temple or a holy city or to restore just general worship. He's going to bring in the mediator between God and man. He's going to totally bridge the gap between sinful man and holy and righteous God. And Matthew 1:18 says this, and this is where the next event that is laid out there that we see happens. It says this: now the birth of Jesus happened in this way. Now the birth of Jesus happened in this way. This was God's Son. That part of the Trinity. That's where the story picks up. That's where our story picks up. That's how we've entered this picture. Because we're not Jews. We haven't been a part of the story. We didn't live during that time. But we enter this picture because Jesus Christ is our Savior. And so we're engrafted in to the family of God and children of God's family. Now the birth of Jesus was in this way. Well, what happens after we have rebuilt? What happens after we have renewed and restored? You know, we're prepared for God to work. We're prepared for him to do something amazing, for God to step forward and do something incredible. Well, we know that Jesus will return. We have that promise from Scripture. Jesus will return. He will come back again. He promised that of his people. What condition is he going to find our house in? What condition is he going to find where we're honoring his house, where we're honoring the Sabbath, where we have separated ourselves from a lost world and we're not living according to their standards and we're not being drawn away and we're not teaching our children the language of the lost, but we're teaching them the language of God and they're able to understand God's word and they're growing in the admonition and the counsel of God's word? Is that the way God finds us? You know, church family, we have a job to do. We have a lot of work to do. It begins in our own homes, and it continues in our neighborhoods and in our city and in our church. On the website, if you are watching this morning from online, from wherever you are, I would encourage you to go to the www.argochristianfellowship.com and to click on the My Response Today and fill out how has God rebuilding your life. What is it? What is the prayer that you want for God in your life and with your house and with your children? What is the legacy that you want to see God do and see when he returns? Remember me, God, for my good. Let's bow and close our eyes and dismiss in prayer. Father, we're so thankful. We're so grateful that you have chosen to work in us, imperfect, sinful man. Father, we're so thankful that fountain of repentance never runs dry, that it is always there for us, that we can drink from it every time that we compromise and we stray and we get away from your word, from your house. Lord, I pray that you would bless your people and that you would inspire us and challenge us from this story of Nehemiah, that you would write our story that would be even greater than the story of Nehemiah. Use our life to impact others for the cause of Jesus Christ. And I pray these things for the sake of Jesus Christ and in his name. Amen. Thank you so much for being here. God bless you. You are dismissed.